We're back again, and tonight we have a special guest. He's an African Reverend, different from the Xaverian missionaries. And we're lucky tonight because this is one of his finale celebrations. After serving 6 years as a missionary to the Philippines in India. And he also sent tapes to took studies in theology at the very prestigious School of Theology. And from there he just graduated as cum laude. Congratulations. And simultaneously he was also mentoring and coaching the young missionaries at the ministry. And so we'd like to we'd like to welcome tonight the very African Reverend Antoine Mushagalusa, Biregeyi, or more fondly called as Rev.Antoine Mushagalusa. Good evening, Reverend, and welcome to the Juno Talk Show.
Thank you.
Simultaneously, this is also a farewell because this is part of his finale celebration. He awaits his priestly ordination by the people when he is assigned out here in Congress. And next week he will be leaving as well after 6 years of efficiently ministering and doing his missionary work for the Philippines. And he has been very efficient as to studying both English and Tagalog. And so he's very full of Tagalog too. Reverend Anthony. So, tell us, Reverend Anthony, what brought you to the Philippines? We know that the Philippines is one of the, it's in fact the biggest Christian country in our nation. And, for you to be ministering where we already have a big population of Christians in the country. So, what really brought you to Manila and the Philippines? Reverend Bishop?
It has been gracious that I came to the Philippines not only to follow the people who have been already Christians and very immersed into the life of God, knowing the meaning of their faith, but also to increase my knowledge of my own faith. And this is specifically through studies of theology. Upon finishing my novitiate in my hometown, I was sent as a missionary to the Philippines by my superior, and I believe this was God's voice as well, to foster my studies in theology, as to encounter also the people in their own experiences of living the faith, and also witnessing to the goodness of God in their own experience of life. So to say that they are already knowledgeable, living out the Christianity is positive. But there is always this part of knowledge, but also there is a part of living. And here in the Philippines, as we just mentioned, most people are Christians, Catholics. And we are happy to be here in this country where we don't struggle actually to meet other people who are not part of our faith, but also they help us to increase our experiences, our knowledge of God, in order to go to other nations, to set our heart on fire, and to go to other places more than even the Philippines. So I came here as a missionary, but also as a student. Now I will be going as fully missionary for other nations.
Well, of course, it's an excellent university because it's there. I also graduated from academia. And thank you. And congratulations, because he has always been an honor student since his elementary days, you know, back in his hometown, until he graduated from the Ateneo as a cum laude. And Reverend, I noticed that, you know, the calling, you know, for missionary work is always limited to, you know, they try to attract, and they try to recruit only the intelligent and wise, you know, the people blessed with higher wisdom. So what is that? Is that a form of discrimination by God? I don't know. I'm sure you would know the answer, Reverend, because, you know, that's why you're in this calling. Would you like to explain?
God is so loving that he even made himself known to the humanity, his creation. And he wanted that he live in relationship with his own world. And mercifully, he showers to those he wants with the gift of vocation. And our vocation, as Pope Francis would say, is to journey toward a common holiness. And it's from that background that God sends his disciples, as at the New Testament, as you have heard from the Gospel of St. Matthew, the last chapter, Jesus himself would say, go to all the nations and proclaim the good news. I think it's there where people also collaborate into the call received from God, not because they are intelligent, not because they are wiser than others, but because the voice of God has happened their hearts in a very practical, different manner. That they feel urged to contribute to the work of the mission and evangelization to let God be known to all the nations.
So you were saying earlier, you know, it's not really that God is discriminatory in granting intelligence and respect to only a few of his flock. But you were saying that he, you know, scatters gifts to everybody, and everyone has his own unique gift. So those who have been lucky enough to receive the gift of deeper understanding of this are the ones, you know, who are easily called and easily drawn to the religious vocation.
I would say that there is this discernment that brings us to match with the call of God. Mm-hmm. Once you are aware that God calls me for something as special as to be a disciple missionary, then you start discerning and checking in to discern the voice of God. Not because really you are intelligent, but by collaborating, you recognize the voice of God in your life. And this will bring you to make way that this grace becomes active in you. So studies, commitments as a missionary, community life, and more improving this relationship between people become means and ways to be a such missionary and to continue to do what God wills for this specific life of this person.
I'm sure you're very aware about the recent developments in you know, our political landscape about Sister Pat, who's an Australian missionary, who got into trouble with our government because she was ministering, you know, dragging the rallies against government. So she got she was asked by the government to leave. And so how do you, you know, try to come up with this kind of challenge, you know, to reverse, to try to work out with different governments, because as we see, it's not only our government, but every government of the world is behaving in, sometimes in, you know, unnatural schedules that is contrary to what God wants a human being to be and what he wants our world to be. So how do you come, try to come up with this challenge of, you know, especially in this world today of, you know, all this nuclear warfare, nuclear warfare, and, you know, all the governments trying to propagate what is moral and righteous, just for the sake of trying to control people and, you know, trying to progress their own countries. So how do you think you should mission as a religious person to try to overcome these kinds that in the end it's good or you know the goodness of man that drives us, God drives us.
As far as I believe that God will touch his human heart, can still touch him, even the most sinner of the world, and bring him to what we call conversion. That's also the faith that I have, that though the world created in all the goodness that is, a human person created likeness and image of God, with all the gifts, the graces that he or she needed, gets astray from this way, God has power.
So you were talking about touching.
Yes.
Individually, you know. So, for instance, do you mean, is this like, for instance, signs? Signs all over that, you know, you should listen to the signs and take this pathway? Is that the way God guides us so that he touches us? Or how do you think, you know, so that people can have a better discernment and more, they can be more mindful about being more like God?
It's to recognize the presence of God into life. Mm-hmm. Because we are a creature, as creation, we are called to be in a relationship, mm-hmm. a very deep relationship with God. And this becomes what we call the personal encounter with our Creator, God Himself. And this touch is not just physical touch. It's the way you encounter God and you feel His call, His message, His holiness happening into your inner being. And then you start the journey.
So you're saying, Reverend, that he you know, touches each one in a special way?
Yes.
What about, for instance, those who have gone astray and they have lost their consciences? I mean, for instance, those who are, you know, mentally deranged, with mental illness, because perhaps their brains have been damaged by drugs. You know, when the brain is damaged, it cannot regenerate anymore. So they remain as like animals, right? And maybe that is the rationale behind our president's tough policy against all these drug dealers. And now, if the President Trump is trying to follow him. So, how do you, you know, try to mentor these kinds of people who already have degenerated into like animals because they have been into drugs or their, you know, this discernment and their decisions are always wrong?
As a missionary, I would feel sorry for reaching out to this final state of being actually destroyed by the nature, destroyed by our choices, destroyed the way we live, that we have in a society some people like that, as you just mentioned, but they need help. These people need help. And actually for that, God is still sending missionaries, as he sent angels also to his chosen ones to try to recall the goodness for which we have been created. And the people in that very state of fully disturbance, behavior, addiction, always the church is available with open hands to welcome them and to find ways to help them so they can again be integrated into society by the power of the healing of process that goes not only spiritually but also psychologically. Mm-hmm. And this integration becomes a very social ability again to live as a normal human being. Mm-hmm. So I feel pity on this situation of some people of our society, but also I believe that the help is still available through the means of the church. I know many priests, many religious organizations who really give effort to the rehabilitation of those drug addicts and those who cannot stand any more human rights decisions. until they are brought a certain healing, assisted by church ministers, church goers, people of God.
What about, because I understand that ministry work, just like government laws work, it's like, you know, control, try to control behavior. Hopefully for the greater good. And always for God, I think, for the greater good. So, but some governments and heads of governments have, you know, sometimes misguided perceptions of what the ultimate goal is. For instance, if they try to, you know, as we all know that God has created all races in different colors in the rainbow, because that is the spice of life. Otherwise, it's going to be boring, and it's not going to be, you know, if for instance, everybody is white or everybody is black. And, you know, for instance, two men get married, you know, or two women do, they will not multiply, right? That is maybe the wisdom behind the variety. But, you know, some heads of government propagate even media. They would try to create this racism, you know, this campaign against colored people. When in fact, you know, colored people create all the spikes and they even elevate. But, you know, because of all this wrongful misconception and maybe some greediness that they want to step up other people and just put their own agendas forward. So they would try to continue on this interesting topic after a few minutes break. Thank you.
Thank you.
Stay tuned.